Hello and welcome to Introduction to Epistemology, and today we are going to discuss the possibility of pervasive error. So what is the meaning of pervasive? It could be defined as in simple word as prevalent or penetrating or extensive, or we can say a widespread throughout some group of people. So when we talk about the pervasive error, the example commonly having with real hallucination. Now the question arises that what is real hallucination? So we can explain in term of, for example, there are some kind of people that have some psychological disorders and they are feeling a real hallucination, or for example delusional disorder, which is a mental illness in which a person cannot tell what is real from what is imagined. And actually there are some disorders, psychological disorders, that can produce hallucinations like schizophrenia or bipolar disorder or psychosis or borderline personality disorders or post-traumatic stress disorder or sleep disorders. In these all cases that I given to you, these all are the psychological disorders that can cause hallucination. So sometimes our observation are not accurate and it leads to pervasive error. We can explain in terms of perfectly realistic hallucination, which is occur without any drug or without any use of drug. And then there is competition between obviously what is true or believing truth, and then to avoid the falsehood as well. So when we talk about skepticism, we are talking not only in terms of truth, but we are also trying to avoid any false fact or falsifications, and that is the beauty of skepticism. So if you take a look of next slide, like the question that I have mentioned, can I know that there is a green field before me? And I have mentioned in blue paragraph, despite the possibility of hallucination, then it appears that my belief remains justified and it is as likely to be true as it can make it by any steps in my power, such as more carefully observing the grassy texture. So what the author is talking about, or what a philosopher is talking, that you know, even a person with realistic hallucination, it could be justified and it could be true. We already discussed justified true belief and justified true in previous lectures. So person, if they are hallucinated because of some psychological disorder, it could be justified and true with his own mind, because we can explain in terms of introspective behavior. And in a person in their own power, it could be observing like a grassy texture. It could be possible. And I mentioned that in the person unconscious, it could be reasonable to believe that there is a grass field. But the problem arises that how can we able to assess that person, that the person is observing the phenomena without any hallucination? And that is the critical thing, because this is plausible and it could lead to false fact or false comfort. So that is why it is very confusing that the person who is judging the phenomena or any observation, that person may have its own hallucinating, and the extent of hallucination is difficult to determine if anyone is having. Or if, for example, someone is thinking in a dream, how can we confirm that? Is it real or it's just a dream that there is a grass green field before me? So that's a question that is difficult to answer. So a question arises that how can we make a balance between believing truth and avoiding falsehood, and which could be explained in terms of skepticism. And that concept was given by Pero in 361 to 270 BCE, and then Sicilius and Carneades, these are all philosophers that give the concept of skepticism. So we have these three Greek philosophers, Pyrrho, Sicilius and Carneades. And the key concept of skepticism is mentioned in this diagram, that skeptics are involved in a continual inquiry for the truth. So it means that there is no stoppage of truth. Then it is the greatest good that comes from the peace of mind, which is also explained as ataraxia, which is achieved by accepting our limits of understanding. Skepticism could be defined as there is no certainty in human knowledge, or it could be a probability of correct morality is enough for acting in a moral fashion. Existing ethical and legal systems are reliable guides. So when we talk about the concept of skepticism, it means that there is no certainty of human knowledge. It means that if we are asking in the previous lecture about quest of knowledge, this would be a never-ending journey for knowledge. Then if we talk about the greatest good is only come through the mind, which is only be achieved by accepting the limit of understanding. If we know our limitation of understanding, then it could be possible to find the correct answer and to avoid the falsehood. Or it is a continuous process. Or it could be a probability of correct morality to determine the boundaries of knowledge, or to determine the ethical and legal system, and to understand the truth within the ethical and legal system. So that can be explained in terms of skepticism. So in the next slide, we are talking about two things. One is knowledge skepticism, and the second is justification skepticism. And in the second paragraph, I have highlighted that there is little knowledge, if any knowledge. We call it as knowledge skepticism. It means that the knowledge is quite limited, because knowledge is a continuous process, as we have discussed in the last slide. Whereas philosophers also target justification. In the last paragraph, I have mentioned that they do not take our justified belief, and they do not consider this as a knowledge that they can explain in terms of justification skepticism. And these all knowledge skepticism and justification skepticism is because of the possibility error, because of the hallucination, and that may cause a hurdle to justify any possibility. And because of the hallucination, it could lead to pervasive errors. So a skepticism is helpful to avoid dogmatism. And what is dogmatism? It is a character of unfounded positiveness in the matter of opinion, or arrogant assertion of opinion as truth. To understand the dogmatic behavior, you can see the next slide, where I have shared a picture of Donald Trump, which was previous president of America. And his personality could be explained in terms of dogmatic behavior, which is explained in terms of strongly expressing your belief as if they were fact. Like, for example, during pandemic, when he was talking about the use of the mouthwashes as an treatment, or when they are talking about the treatment of COVID-19, he's talking about the use of hydroxychloroquine, which is a drug which was at that time not yet approved, and it was still under clinical trial. So he was talking about some injection of the antiseptics, or he was talking about the use of hydroxychloroquine drugs. So let me share you some skepticism about knowledge and justification which Descartes and Hume give. Hume is a Scottish philosopher, and Descartes, everybody know, is also a philosopher. So according to them, skepticism about knowledge is like Descartes mentioned, we conclude we cannot absolutely certain about the external world, perhaps we can live with this. So this is a beautiful philosophy given by Descartes. Whereas Hume tell about justification is that Hume is here to tell us we have no reason whatsoever to believe certain things we thought obvious, and this would be hard to live. And I have taken from some source of Tristan Cornwell. So this is explained skepticism in a beautiful way given by Descartes and Hume. So the skepticism can be present in terms of different dimensions and variety, which could be related to subject or could be related to the time zone like past or future, or the object which could be physical, or the mind which could be a thought process. It could be optimistic attitude that contain knowledge, justification like justified belief, or suspended judgments. It could be explained in terms of modality or contingency, which is the condition or necessity, or it could be explained in terms of a posteriori or versus a priori, or it could be explained in terms of the person, which is human, subhuman or superhuman. That each of these four varieties or dimension explains skepticism in different context. But how can we differentiate between a priori or a posteriori? We can explain in terms of the difference of knowledge, whereas in priori we are talking knowledge is independent of experience, whereas in a posteriori it explained in terms of knowledge with experience. So when we explain a priori, we are talking about mathematics or logic or abstract reasoning, whereas in a posteriori we are talking about experimentation and science. That's how we can differentiate between both context, a priori or a posteriori. So when we talk about skepticism in a priori or a posteriori, the context both is different and then it could be explained in different way. Like for example, we already mentioned about different dimensions and variety of skepticism, and in the fourth point we mentioned that the skepticism could be explained in different context, in human, subhuman or superhuman. So how can we differentiate these three categories? A subhuman example is like a dolphin intelligence. It could be explained as subhuman, or the human is the intelligence that we have, or the superhuman, like there are different people that are believed to be a superhuman in nature because of their cognitive abilities. Or in comic characters, we always talk about different superhumans. So the context of skepticism varies depend upon different categories, whether it is the modality, or it could be a kind of object, or it could be depend upon the time, which could be present or past. So it is not generalized information or knowledge. It could be varies with different context. So thank you so much for today's lecture, and hope to see you again.